So how are you?
All the better for seeing you.
When's the last time you did one of these?
I never was on a junket before.
Never? Have you spent a lot of time talking to press, to media, over the years?
Well, a considerable time, because I've been in this business over 80 years. So in the course of time, I've spoken to the press.
Is talking to the press okay, fun for you, or?
I enjoy it. I don't know how to call it fun. I enjoy it. There's a difference.
So what is the difference?
Between fun and enjoying?
Yeah.
Well, enjoying is a whole aspect of a thing where you have a certain, even intellectual perhaps, understanding and stimulation and probing and all that. Whereas fun is just a funny word.
So you've worked with, obviously, some of the greatest directors of all time.
I was fortunate enough to do that.
So where do you put Judd in this group?
Where do I put Judd?
Yeah.
Judd is his own man. He is not to be compared to anyone. I don't mean that in a funny way or derogatory way. I mean, he is his own island, so to speak. He's not like Hitchcock, he's not like Orson, he's not like Charlie Chaplin, even though they are in generally a comic feel, perhaps, mm-hmm. but it's a totally different thing, different world entirely. He's not like Renoir. Each of those men had a separate story, which they told as individuals through their material. And Jed does too. Jeb does too. But it's his own thing. And it's a cliche, I suppose, to say it's very much of today. It's what's happening in the world today. Mm-hmm. With Judd, you feel very up to date and present. You don't feel any romantic, sentimental nonsense of the past. This is the way the world is today.
So were the great directors romantic and sentimental?
I'm thinking of them as you ask it. I think Hitchcock was romantic but not sentimental. But he always had a man who was tall, dark, and handsome, like Cary Grant or Jimmy Stewart or Joel McRae or someone, and a blonde. Always a blonde as the woman. You can run them off yourself. So he always had that romantic quality, and he looked for that because he knew that within this, in the realm of suspense, which he specialized in, a romantic element makes it doubly delicious. Because it makes you care more for the principles. Of course, it's a definition about what you mean by romantic. Jean Renoir.
Pretty romantic.
He had Jean Gabin and some wonderful leading ladies. But in their way, which was a different world, the French world, but in their way, they were Jean Gabin, I don't know of a more romantic leading man. But it was a different world, you see. And it was not sentimental at all. It was tough. It was very worldly. And above all, the genius of Chaplin was that he had you laughing and crying and caring and seeing things in an extraordinary way, his own, the greatest actor in the world, but how romantic it was with the girl. So that, for example, when at the end of City Lights, The blind girl realizes this is the man who's been paying for her cure. Mm-hmm. And she now sees for the first time and sees Charlie. By recognizing the touch of his hand. Mm. Can't be more romantic than that, or more wonderful. It's a combination. So yes, in reply to your question, there are, these fellows had a great sense of life and of love and of people. They knew people.
So did you, when you were doing the work, did you know that you were working with geniuses, or were you just doing the work?
Well, I always felt that the people I've mentioned were geniuses when I worked with them. I felt Charlie was unquestionably a genius, and Hitch was absolutely a genius in his way. It was a special thing. And Renoir, I mean, he encompassed within himself a whole world of people, France. And have I left out someone?
Maybe Orson?
Hmm?
Orson?
Orson. Orson had a theatricality. He made room for you if you came to him with a performance. He knew how to stage it. Mm. And as a matter of fact, I think I am quoting him. I think he said that one day. You bring me a performance, I know what to do with it. Mm. And in that area, he had genius because he had a theatricality that was overwhelming. The most theatrical of all the directors we've ever had.
In real life as well?
Hmm?
In real life as well?
Yeah, he was a very theatrical person. He was, first of all, physically, he was big. Hmm. And he went up and down in weight. At the end, he got 300 pounds. Hmm. But in our time, when we worked together, he had a pretty good figure. He was about maybe 200. And he was a doll to work with. I found him very easy to work with. Mm. Of course, he did put on tantrums. And they were very amusing because during them you could read your newspaper. So while he yelled and screamed at John Houseman, and then John Houseman screamed back, you would sit there and I'd catch up on my box scores. Everyone would sit there, just ignore it. It was just going. But it was part of the game. Mm. And he was great. He was great.
What was it, do you think, about you that put you in position with all these... What do you think it is about you that led you to all of these kind of great talents?
You know, that's an interesting question. I just sort of bounced there. Let's say, in regard to Hitch, John Houseman, with whom I'd worked at the Mercury with Orson, mm-hmm. recommended me to Hitch. With Orson, I had been on the WPA, the Federal Theater, so had Orson. And when Orson left the WPA with John Houseman to form the Mercury, mm-hmm. I was leaving the Federal Theater, and they offered me a chance to come with them. Mm-hmm. So that's how I met Orson. Jean Renoir, you know, someone, I think it may have been my agent, he was casting a picture called The Southerner. And I don't know how that happened. I had a meeting with him and he became one of my dearest friends.
Well, that's, I mean, this with Say Wells, for instance, when you met.
To what?
The circumstances in which you met Wells, right? You met this, you were changing things, both of you. But did you become friends instantly? Did you share things?
No, Austin and I were never friends.
Never.
I must tell you, there was always in our relationship, although I love working with him, a sort of distance. Mm. I think he felt I was measuring him. He was just ignoring it, except he wasn't. Mm. So that when at the end the Directors Guild devoted a week to Orson, 5 days, each day a separate facet of his talent. Mm. And I was asked to appear about what he brought from the theater into films. Mm-hmm. And I appeared with Kenneth Tynan, the eminent critic, mm-hmm. and Roger Hill, I think his name was, who was Orson's schoolmaster in Illinois, I believe it was, or somewhere. Mm-hmm. And I appeared, and Tynan, when we did our thing, mm. it was over. Orson appeared, and we all gathered on the stage to how to do's and goodbyes. And this is the last time I saw Orson in person. And Orson and I moved towards each other, and he took me in his arms and he embraced me in this great embrace, like a bear. And he leaned down and he whispered in my ear, "You son of a bitch." And that's the last I saw of him.
He knew how to make an exit.
Yeah. So that I always took that as a term of affection. And it was. We had an affection for each other. After I left the Mercury, he did ask me to come back when he was going to do The Five Kings. He never quite did that production. He may have done a road production, but I don't know. Chimes at Midnight may have been The Five Kings in a version that Orson made. But he wanted me to play Jack Cade, who is in Henry V, who is a villainous type. And he said, you'll be coming back. When are you coming back? And so on. Mm. So he was very kind in that respect.
Were you typed as an actor in those early years? I mean, Sabotage? Typed. As a villain, as a bad guy? Or were you...
No, not typed. Sinner the Poet was not a villain.
That's true.
He was a beautiful, beautiful character. Of great dimension. I played the clown on the WPA, An Injunction Granted. The play was about the history of labor in the courts, and I played the clown who commented on all these industrial types. Mm. So no, I played, and in another Living newspaper, called Power, which was about TVA, the creation of TVA, mm-hmm. I played the typical consumer, the victim. Huh. So no, I wasn't always a villain. It was Hitch who saw the possibilities of making me into a villain by just setting me up. I didn't do anything. He just set me into these scenes. Mm. You know, you have me sitting in the back of a cab, and I look off, and you cut to what I see, which is the Normandy on its side, and then you come back to me and I smile, and you got a villain. I mean, you don't have to do anything. Hitch sets you up beautifully. He's done that with a lot of fellows.
So do you ever remember not being in show business? You started apparently very, very early.
I was doing little performances around at ladies' clubs and that my mother would, but also in school and so on and so forth. And some and studying at the Stage Children's Fund, which existed before the professional school. And so from that, I got a whole sense of performance and would sometimes appear at benefits on a full stage, I mean, in Broadway theater. So all of that was preparatory. At 15, I retired.
For how long?
2 years. At the end of that time, I thought I'd get an education, you see. Not a... At the end of that time, I heard that Eva Le Gallien, she had a repertory theater, and a very fine one. And she was going to put apprentices on the theater. That is to say, she had a basic company. Mm-hmm. But then she wanted to attach 25 boys, 25 girls as apprentices who would play extras, walk-ons, and all this kind of thing. So I auditioned for that at the age of 17, and fortunately she accepted me. Mm. And I was off and running into the professional theater.
So were you deeply in love with the whole theater world? Was that...
What?
Were you deeply in love with the whole theater world, the whole life of the theater?
Passionate. And when you ask that question, deeply in love, long before I started, when I was a kid, when I was 8, 9, 10, I knew who Al Jolson was. I knew who Eddie Cantor was. I knew who Miller and Lyles, the black team. Mm. They were big stars in the black theater. I knew about all of them because I went to the theater from the time I was 9 or 10, and saw these great performers, which we don't have anymore.
Because vaudeville doesn't exist anymore. Mm-hmm. Because vaudeville doesn't exist anymore, or?
That's one of the reasons, yes. One of the main reasons. And these people worked in vaudeville, came out of vaudeville. When they were not working in a play, they worked in vaudeville and so on. Mm. And they had wonderful acts. Jimmy Barton, wonderful actor, later played in Tobacco Road. He didn't create it, Henry Hull did. But he went into it, he was wonderful. Jimmy Barton was one of our great actors. Mm. He had a vaudeville act called the Mad Dog Act. He had an imaginary dog, always trying to bite him as he's trying to talk. And he brought that dog to life. It was amazing. And there were others too. And of course, Jolson, Cantor, I'd steal their material. They would have songs and I would steal them. What was the song I stole from Jimmy Barton? Father, get the hammer, there's a fly on baby's head. I stole that song.
So was it, for you, did they translate to film? I mean, I think there's a general feeling. I think there's a general feeling that those great live performers didn't really translate to film as well.
No. I've seen Jolson's act that he did in film, and it's, let me tell you, Chaplin once told me that Al Jolson was the most mesmerizing figure he ever saw on the stage doing his act. And you know, Jolson used to say, keep the show running till 10 o'clock, then everybody get away, get off, disappear, I'll take it. And he did. Mm. He would also, according to legend, the Winter Garden, I think, was really built for him, mm-hmm. and in New York. But I also had heard, and I believe it, he loved the races. And very often there were times on a Wednesday matinee when Jolson would buy off the whole performance,
really?
Pay the Schuberts, and go to the track. and not give the performance. But he loved horses. But he was an amazing performance. I saw him in a play called Bumbo And the audience was right in the palm of his hand. Mm.
So you've acted over many, many, many years, up till this last year, 99, I guess you gave your performance in Trainwreck. Has acting changed, really, in that time?
Did you say I'm 99?
Well, you were when you made Trainwreck.
When I made Spellbound?
When you made this, Trainwreck.
Oh.
I think it was on your 99th year, yes?
When did I shoot?
Before November.
Yeah.
But I mean,
was I 99? I thought I was already 100.
Maybe. Yeah. But has acting changed in any real way? I mean, I know what's put out has changed, but has the work changed?
Things have changed. First of all, in what actors speak and say, and their attitude towards what they speak and say has changed. Is raunchy the word?
It can be.
Whatever the word. But never in my time as a child, but over the years until now, do they have scenes which discuss and the language that you have today. I don't want to be I don't want it to sound as if I'm disapproving. I say it's just changed. Mm-hmm. Also, I think actors, they've gotten less flamboyant. Mm. They've gotten, there's a corner, this is so individual on my part, and I don't say this is the case, but to me it is. There's a contradiction in what I've just said, but on the other hand, you know what I mean. Mm-hmm. I think actors have lost their big style. You had big stars once. On Broadway, you had the Lunts. My goodness, there's nothing to compare with the Lunts. Mm-hmm. You had wonderful actors, I could list him. Well, I was talking about Jolson and Cantor, but legitimate actors, Walter Huston, and I'm not mentioning them all, but they were big. Actors, maybe it's the influence of the method, the Stanislavski method, and also the interest of being true. And so forth. But it was Dürrenmatt who said, one day an actor forgot his lines, and thus realism was born. That's what's happened. The attempt to be real has made, for me, a dullness in most acting. I like the swashbuckler.
So do you still consume a lot? Do you watch movies and television much? Do you watch much television or film?
No.
Have you?
That must be an actor. He heard me say what I said. Do I watch much television?
Or film, or?
No.
Had you, or was it?
I don't. It could be my lack, my fault, but I don't get anything out of it.
So there was also a middle period of your life where you were blacklisted. The blacklist era of your life.
The what?
The blacklist.
Oh, what about?
How big a chunk of that, did it change you? Did it change the world? Did it change Hollywood?
Yes. It lasted 7 years. I went back to the theater and helped start with T. Edward Hambledon, was the producer with Norrie Houghton. But Hume Cronin, Jessica Tanner, and I did the first play of the Phoenix Theater. That was in 1953, I think. And that theater went on for about 40 years. So I, one was cut off from an economic thing like the motion pictures. Mm-hmm. And I had a family to support, my kids, my wife. And we went back to New York and I went back in the theater. Did that for a while. And then there was Hitchcock, who brought me back. And it's interesting that when he wanted me to come back and work on a television show as associate to the producer, who was Joan Harrison, a beautiful, lovely, superb producer. I learned how to produce from Joan. And what happened was Hitch wanted me, and they had to submit my name to the network. Mm-hmm. And the network said, there's a problem. That was the euphemism. Mm-hmm. And they came back. Alan Miller, who represented Universal at the time, went back to Hitch and said, well, there seems to be a problem with Norman. And Hitch said three words. I want him. It's the end of everything. There was no blacklist, there was nothing. He was, I was back at work. So you see how ridiculous the thing was.
Did it change how you felt about the work at all?
No. I always loved it. And I loved working for Hitch and Joan. Mm-hmm. And it was a great job for 8 years. I mean, with such knowledgeable people, and you felt brought into the picture with them. Mm-hmm. And we made a good show. I say Alfred Hitchcock Presents, and Alfred Hitchcock is a good show.
Yeah. So have you had a preference over all these years? You've done almost everything. Do you prefer acting? Do you prefer producing? Do you prefer theater to television or film?
I love acting more than anything because of one reason, the audience. When you're acting in the theater, I'm talking about. Mm-hmm. When you're in the theater and you're playing in King Lear, which I did with Lou Cowherd, played the fool. Your relationship with the audience is palpable. It is remarkable. You sail on that, you ride on that. Not from an ego sense of view, but from a common thing. You're creating something, a Mr. Shakespeare, pretty good guy, and you're creating that. And it's working, and they are getting it, and you're both participating in that. The relationship to an audience. And they to you. And of all the forms, so to speak, that's when I was the happiest. I loved working in pictures, and I had great time. I did a series called Saint Elsewhere, which I think was as rewarding as any film. I think it was brilliant. The writing was so brilliant.
So is that what excited you about that you knew how good it was?
That what?
That you knew how good the writing was and how good the show was while you were doing it?
Oh, yes. I was very much aware of that. Always aware. And most appreciative of Tom Fontana, who was the chief writer. Mm-hmm. But yes, we had good actors in the show, but it was the writing that made that show. Mm. And I thought while doing it, how lucky I am that this writing is coming in every day. And you know, the particularly led by Tom Fontana, mm-hmm. when they got into a thing, they would Tom would ask you about things in your life. Mm. He's a kid, he's going to school, or later on starting. And before you know it, he would incorporate this in the script of St. Elsewhere. Mm. So I said many things as Dr. Ausländer, which were really out of my own life, which Tom wrote after he pried them loose from me. He's a darling man. To reply to your question, my favorite medium was the theater. Mm. Despite my enthusiasm about St. Elsewhere.
What got you to decide to do Trainwreck? What got you to make that decision?
Well, I live on a road, a very beautiful road in Los Angeles, and my next door neighbor is Ed O'Connor. Is that his name in modern family?
Ed O'Neill.
Ed O'Neill, yes. Ed O'Neill. Ed O'Neill. Lives next door. And one day, walking along on the road, and I stopped and said, Hi, and we chatted. What are you doing? He said. I said, nothing. And he said, I got to talk to them. So I got into an episode of Modern Family, which I had a lot of fun. Really great fun doing it. And then out of it, somehow Ed said, you know, you should meet Judd Apatow. So Ed set up a lunch, which he could not attend. But I did, and Judd did, with Barry Mendel, and another, Barry Mendel and Judd, and there was a writer there, I forgot. We had a lovely lunch, and about 2 weeks later, I always tell the story that at the end of the lunch, Judd said, where's your car parked? I said, a couple of blocks away. He said, I'll walk you to it. So we walked to the car with Barry. And I look back on that moment. That was my audition, because he wanted to see if I could still walk. I always say that. And I could walk, and he put me in the picture. Mm.
And it was fun to do.
Wonderful fun. First of all, there was no script for me. Mm. It was all ad lib, particularly with Gavin and a little bit with Amy, but mostly with Gavin, who I think is absolutely great. And he sounds just like Jimmy Cagney, but he doesn't look like him. And we had wonderful improvisations. Mm. Some of the stuff you could use.
So you got raunchy. Hmm? You got raunchy.
I got what?
Did you get raunchy? Raunchy?
Oh, raunchy. Well, there was one point where Judd said, you're in Paris. We got into Paris in the improvisation. I don't know how we did it. From Babe Ruth, we went to Paris. And Judd said, you're in Paris. I said, yes. And then at one point said, and you're inside Josephine Baker. I was rather nonplussed. How did it feel, goes the improvisation, being inside Josephine Baker? So I could only answer one thing. I said, comfortable. my dear girl, I didn't mean to offend you.
Thank you so much for your time.
Oh, thank you. What a way to end it.